rabbit rambled out of Brewer Town, but he didn't get far before he turned around. He was running from his wife, but didn't know where to go, so he ended up with his old coach, Totharo, a big tired dwarf who said, "Do what the heart commands. The heart is our only guide." Tart or jazz, old-fashioned, or just your typical lack of passion, was the match appealer part of the equation that led him to the farmer at the service station. The farmer said, the only way to get somewhere, you know, is to figure out where you're going before you go. So Harry Rabbit Angstrom meets Ruth Leonard with Totharo over a Chinese dinner. He says, "Are you a horse?" He says, "Are you a rat?" But the truth is he liked her, though she was a little fat. Why is Rabbit drinking daiquiris at a Chinese restaurant? Only in Reading. I mean, Brewer. Good Lord. So the Springers sent the Reverend to bring back Rabbit, but mostly he instills a lifelong habit of looking for grace and a perfect hit. Harry's got a natural swing. He shouts, "That's it. Hole in one. Perfect shot." Eccles can't get Rabbit back till the baby's born, and even then our hero is torn. At the minister's wife, Rabbit makes a pass, a crisp little number. He slaps her sassy ass. It felt so good, just right, dense, yet springy. Now Rabbit runs more in fun and games. It's got tragedy and plenty of shame. Rabbit's gotta pull the plug where baby Becky died. The water rushes down the drain with a vortical cry. Even at the funeral he runs. Ah, runs, runs. Rabbit Redux or Rabbit Redo? No one seems to know, not even Harry, says J.U. Janice is out, Jill and Skeeter are in, and Harry's fascinated by the latter's black skin, the peculiar glinting luster. Now speaking of Skeeter, he was a Vietnam veteran with a Jesus complex and a tendency to lecture. But Baby Chuck and Lady Chuck and Chuck took their lessons. Penn Villa's vanilla and the neighbors have some questions. Eddie Rumback says, "What kind of pervert are you bringing up there?" Requested out there at a 26 Vista Crescent. She got her guitar from a transaction, you could say, with Ollie Fosnack. "Farewell, Angelina, the bells of the crown are being stolen by bandits. I must follow the sound. The triangle tingles, the music plays slow. Farewell, Angelina, the sky is on fire, and soon I must go." But Jill was a kid, and a comely lass, raised in the bosom of the middle class. Dad, and on the hood of one was a Mercedes star. Her boyfriend, a born loser, with teeth pearly white, he fucked sweet virgin Jill throughout one sandy night. She saw that his brown skin was dead. She dim with each frightened breath. She hopped in her Porsche and she drove away. And that's why she's living with you two creeps today. But Harry had to cash in Peggy Fosnack. So farewell, Jill the Hilly. The house is on fire. Skeeter's not coming back. Now where were we? Was it Mim, Steele, and Charlie that brought Janice home to the Safe Haven Motel with a bat and telephone? It's a hesitant reunion, uncertain at best, and what happens next is anybody's guess. He Rabbit, she Janice, sleeps. Okay? Is rich. 1979, end of June, Springer Motors display room. He's the king of the lot, the chief salesman, and he's reached a truce with that dumb mutt Jan. Though sometimes he liked to hit her on the head with that green glass egg in Ma Springer's living room. Back on the lot, there's a couple of hicks, and way out yonder in the Galilee sticks, the girl's his daughter, it's the truth, and blue eyes, deep sockets, you remember Ruth Leonard, our buyer now, though she can't be bought, at least not by Rabbit. So Rabbit takes the kids for a test drive. He doesn't make the sale, but it's good to be alive. Gross markup average, a lot of money brings. Harry turns on the radio and Donna Summer sings. Sitting here eating my heart out, waiting, waiting for some lover to call. Dialed about 1,000 numbers lately. I almost rang my phone off the wall. Looking for some hot stuff, baby, this evening. I need some hot stuffin', baby, tonight. I want some hot stuffin', baby, this evening. Gotta have some hot stuff, gotta have some love tonight. Now hot stuff for Harry is Cindy Merkitt, but on the trip to the island he taps Thelma's sweet shit. But that's not enough, so he takes a golden shower. Harry's motivated by control and power over Ronnie Harrison, the old master wins again. But seriously, Rabbit kinda coveted Webb Merkitt's wife. With descriptions of her body, the novel is rife. She's got a cross around her neck, her bikini's awful neat, but Rabbit is obsessed with Cindy Merkitt's feet. Toes side by side, like candies in a box. Suck. Back on the home front, things are pretty weird. Nelson's back in town, says his father may be queer. He never got over the tragedy of Jill. To him, Harry's a fraud over the hill. No one seems to realize how nasty Harry C. Angstrom is, Nelson says, all big and fuzzy and sly. And he's a killer, body count of 2 to his credit. But hey, Rabbit is rich, the story is told. He makes love to Janice on a bed of gold at the Krugerrands. Even in the sad realm of family, Nelson's wife Prue hands him her baby to see. A granddaughter, his. Another nail in his coffin, his. listening to the psalm ought to put you to the test, but I ain't even got to a rabbit at rest. I'll try to keep it short, short as can be. Rabbit's gone down to the Gulf Coast Sea, Valhalla Village, Pindo Palm Boulevard, Building B, number 413. Now Harry's heart is full of crud and his chest is in a bind. He always thought there was something waiting for him to find it. Could it be death itself on a sunfish ride? Little Judy saves him singing nursery rhymes. Well, until she gets into the commercials, it is a consumer society, you know. Staving off Harry's sky enemy, she sings, if I was an Oscar Mayer wiener, 'cause that is what I really like to be. And if I was an Oscar Mayer wiener, then everyone would be in love with me. Now the figures don't add up, there's trouble on the lot. Nelson's a poisonous presence, a real sore spot. He's white around the gills with a rat tail. Under his so-called leadership, the dealership fails. He blows it right up his nose. Nelson tells Janice, I love Coke, Mom, and it loves me. Well, Nelson's a crackhead, but Harry's also nasty. Fucks his daughter-in-law after his angioplasty. That working girl Janice says forgive she never will. So Harry packs his bags and Nitrostat pills. She called him monstrous. Rabbit knows where to go on his final run. And back down south, Billion. He blows out his heart on a dirty, dusty court. Jan and Nelson make it down, but Harry pulls up short. Harry tells Nelson, it isn't so bad. Enough, maybe, enough. Let's get this over with, the dude declare. Harry's occupation with the wild fact of pubic hair. His name is Harry. He even thinks it grows in the grave. Of course, this was before everybody shaved. I don't know how a nice boy from Shillington came up with this stuff. You got your fur, moss, gorgeous black bush, springy triangle, ferny meadow, scarcely a shadow, amber fuzz, dust darkened towards the center to an upright, dainty mane, a shadowy mane, reddish and skimpy enough to see the slit, a pubic patch that seems to bristle at his touch, rat fur, a ginger in color like her mother's, a deep jungle smell down between the ferns, jet black, darker than he imagined, the shape of it from this angle, a kind of T, a curved, snug mass of eyebrow hairs. The constitutional triumph of open beaver, huh? Harry C. Angstrom, pubic philosopher. You should look at a woman's eyebrows, not their hair on their head, for the color of her pussy. Whoa! Well, it's all about Harry, and it always was. And Brewer, Penn Villas, and Old Mount Judd. I guess this is the end of the tetralogy. The thing about Harry, he's a bit like you and me. Fallible, but lovable. Criminal, yet never caught. Semi-detached, like those houses in the red flower pot city. Uncle Sam, American, in the happiest fucking country the world has ever seen.